Yo, what's up, guys? Welcome back. We got to check this out more in depth, okay? This is my first shot at it right here. Let's see how much we learn about that McMurtry Speirling. The unusual engineering explained, okay? This car is crazy. You can see it in the screenshot right here. It's just a crazy-looking car. Really weird dimensions, rather small, but not small in numbers, that's for sure. Well, I guess technically it would be smaller. Lower lap times, right? This thing is setting records. Was absolutely unbelievable at this year's Goodwood. I have a video on that. Make sure to check it out if you missed it. I am loving this thing. Who isn't, actually? Who isn't right now? This thing is just kind of breaking the internet, right? It is taking the automotive world, by the balls right now, right? I mean, let's get real. This thing's a beast. Super fast, crazy technology. That's learned about it. That's what I heard from the comments in the last video. You guys did a good job kind of introducing me to it and suggesting some different things. So let's learn about it here. If we don't learn everything, or if this isn't even the best video on this subject, you can suggest even better ones. I'm sure there's a lot out there right now on this car, and we can definitely check them out. This video is from B Sports. It'll be linked in the description down below. Let's get straight to it, guys. This car is insane. Let's learn a little bit more about it. Shall we? Come on.
Let's talk about a very special car today that just broke the Goodwood Hill Climb record, the McMurtry Speirling. I wanted to do a video about this car a while ago, but there was not much confirmed information about it. Now this changed around this year's Festival of Speed in Goodwood. The project started in 2016, when former aircraft engineer David McMurtry formed a group of XF1 engineers around him to build a lightweight electric track car. They were specifically looking at technology that had been banned in motorsports, and since McMurtry was working on jet engines before, they decided to experiment with fan-driven vacuum systems.
That's a picture of what looks to be some sort of open-wheel race car, maybe even an F1 car, I'm not really sure, with a fan. So I know nothing about this. Somehow in all of my, at least from an American perspective, my motorsport following experience, people I know, and just my own leisure time, looking, being into cars my whole life. For some reason, I just had no idea this was even a thing. I've never came across, of all the crazy stuff I've seen, I've never came across a car that had fans involved in this way, right? I didn't know about this, whatever car this is. Like I said, until a week ago, I didn't even know about this crazy car we're learning about right now. It's very fascinating. It shows that we are at a crazy time, right? I mean, technology always evolves, and cars have just reached crazy heights in the past decade or so. It's really crazy.
At first, they needed a test vehicle, which had enough space for the vacuum system and measuring equipment. So they wanted a van. But they needed a fast van, because they wanted to test the system on racetracks. So they bought an old ambulance, the fastest van available. It must have been the weirdest test vehicle for a new generation of track cars people have ever seen. But the tests were successful, and they could gain valuable experiences. They designed the Speirling from scratch, with the vacuum system in its center. The result of earlier tests was that the vacuum area underneath the car doesn't actually have to be too large to generate a lot of downforce.
Okay.
In fact, the sealed area underneath is only about a square meter. In comparison, the floor area of a GT3 car is around 9 square meter.
Oh, wow.
The seals are ceramic plates. The air is sucked out of the cavity through two fans. If the complete downforce of the car relies on a fan system only, you want more than one fan in case it fails. Another experience McMurtry brought in from aviation. Wow. The fans then push the air to the wake area at the back of the car, where they leave through relatively small outlets. This can then create some extra thrust for the car. One of the huge problems of the Brabham fan car in F1 was that it sucked dirt and stones up from the street and was shooting it towards the cars behind it.
Oh no.
To avoid that, the Speirling has air filters which need regular cleaning.
Okay.
Another result of the intensive testing was that the better the sealing works, the less power the fans need for the same amount of downforce. Something we know from Hoovers. So actually, by creating a decent seal, the power for the fans is relatively low and tends to zero.
Jeez.
Another factor to make this car work is an active suspension to create a stable aero platform, so the sealing and hence the fan system can work properly. But working with a fan car also means that we have to readjust to the new characteristics.
Let's just appreciate this real quick. Look at this thing. This is absolutely crazy. You gotta love it, right? You gotta love when something like this in an already oversaturated, crazy industry like automobiles, where everyone has their own flair, their own pros, their own strengths, their own weaknesses, and everyone's always, especially nowadays, really trying to push the envelope with new technologies, the more efficiency, more power, everything. It's a crazy time. To see something like this that still is totally unique and kind of just blows everything out of the water. I mean, it's just so bizarre in a good way. It's really awesome. This thing is wild. It looks like something, like I said, I'm going to say it again. It looks cartoonish. It looks like a cartoon car or like a Hot Wheels, like some sort of toy. And I mean that in the best way. It's so cool. This is a real car that you can drive and set records in. Obviously, it's very small, and that's not a bad thing. It kind of has to be, right? I could not fit in that. Tell me that down below. Could you fit in this thing? That's a question,
maximum downforce of 2,000 kilogram is always available. And that is also the reason why the car has only rear-wheel drive. Because okay. It always has traction, which enables 3G in corners, no matter what speed, and 1.4 seconds to 100 kilometers per hour.
I respect that too, because you know what? I still like variation. Some cars are front wheel drive, some are rear, and some are all. And I know it seems like in the last, you know, couple decades, all wheel drive has really been super popular and almost taken over, right? Like so many fast cars are all wheel drive. It's kind of the go to. So it's really cool to have something record shattering that's not all wheel drive. It's not depending on all wheel drive. It's actually rear wheel drive. I like that.
And even for recuperation, it always has so much downforce that it can regenerate enough energy only through the rear wheels. And a quick comparison to Gordon Murray's fan car. Both are called fan car, but their systems are entirely different. The T50 has an aggressive diffuser shape, which separates the flow when the fan is off. Only when the fan is on, the low energy boundary layer is sucked away and the high energy flow can follow the aggressive shape. Check out my other video for more information.
Yeah, I gotta learn about that car at some point. I didn't know about either of these 2 weeks ago or so. So, I mean, this is very interesting to me. I really am not going to act like I know about this car. I don't, but I know that it is a fan car as well. And like you said, it's a little bit different. But both of these, I mean, seriously, bravo. Pushing the envelope, really, really different. It's fascinating. It really is.
Creates a rectangular vacuum underneath the car. The next interesting fact about the design is that because the fan system creates all the downforce, the Speirling is initially designed with a body that concentrates on drag reduction only, and not downforce like usual race cars. So the focus was on low drag and not downforce, because downforce comes from the fan system. But that on the other hand meant that the 2 tons of downforce are always there and also don't change with speed. A normal race car increases downforce with velocity squared.
Yeah.
So especially in high speed corners, traditional race cars suddenly had more downforce than the Speirling. So they added a two-element rear wing at the back that is backed off at the sides to reduce induced drag and backed off in the center because of the different approaching angle of the flow. With this wing, they add some traditional downforce to the car.
Wow.
And if you run such a fan car, you basically only need that vacuum area underneath the car and nothing else. So similar to the Brabham fan car, there's no need for a diffuser. Also a good reason to position the license plate there.
No kidding.
Interesting is also the downward slope of the bodywork at the sides. The air is guided directly to the radiators at the back.
Jeez,
so when we saw the car driving at Goodwood, we could see how the dust off the street came out of the two outlets in the center and the wake expanded to the side behind the radiators.
Yeah.
There was a bit of upwash because of the rear wing above, but not the amounts that we are used to from GT3 cars.
Yeah, I did notice that. It's a great point. You can, I mean, see, you're literally seeing the aero in action because I did notice you could see almost like a dusty debris cloud behind it as it was flying past our point of view.
The Speirling houses a self-developed and self-produced U-shaped battery. It wraps around the driver's seat and underneath the legs.
Very
it should
interesting
be able to have a range
shape
of 500
design.
Kilometers, which means an average consumption of 12 kilowatt hours on 100 kilometers. The weight is little under 1,000 kilogram. The power is 1,000 horsepower.
Jeez.
Interesting about driving a fan car is also that any additional ground clearance, for example, if you drive over a curb, will decrease the sealing effect and there will be a sudden loss of downforce.
Oh,
on the other
yeah.
hand, traditional downforce cars have to lift the brake while the car is slowing down because the downforce is reducing. Not here, because it always stays the same. Also, the downforce level of the fan system can be adjusted in any situation. You could even simulate a traditional speed-dependent downforce if you want. But, and that's the huge advantage, you can also switch the downforce off where you don't need it, on the straights for example.
Okay.
Usual downforce cars have to deal with huge amounts of vertical force on the straights, which increases tire drag. Additionally, this means that these cars need to be built to withstand much more force, although it's unnecessary. The Speirling can just switch the downforce off on the straights, and hence doesn't experience these high unnecessary forces.
Wow.
And hence can be designed lighter. So the McMurtry Speirling is a fascinating machine that picked up banned motorsport technology and developed it further to an amazing vehicle that also builds the bridge to future technology. Breaking the record at Goodwood gave them the attention they deserve, and let's see how they will improve the car further.
Yeah, great points in this. Nice, short and concise. I'll be honest, this car is still a little bit out of my comprehension. It's just bizarre, right? I mean, it's amazing. Nothing like I've ever seen before. It's just wild. Good things about this car is, A, I'm glad it's getting recognition because I didn't know about it. I'm sure, you know, a lot of people did not know about it. You know, maybe some people knew about this last year or even earlier. That's great. But, you know, a lot of people didn't, including myself. So it's great to see this car kind of making a name. It's getting put on the map, right? It really is. All that attention and motivation, why not make it even better? Let's see what they can do to even further evolve the car. And also, this paves the way for a whole new potential for the industry, right? I mean, geez, this is just crazy. This car is crazy on so many levels. This was a pretty good explanation. There's probably even more to it. And if you would like me to check out more on this car, please let me know down below in the comments. Help me out with some suggestions, some other things to know about it. Let's have a conversation down there. You guys always do great with that. This thing is just wild. It really is wild. Is there anyone out there that doesn't like this car? I find that hard to believe. I like it. I think a lot of people do. It's just so funny and awesome and crazy and fast. It just came out of the woodworks and it's like, yep, I'm gonna take that trophy. I mean, it's just crazy. Like, I think of it as like, oh, I'm gonna pull up to the start line. People might laugh at me and I'm gonna break a record. Like, you know, like, what's up? That is the McMurtry Speirling. That is from B-Sports. It'll be linked in the description down below. Make sure to check it out and watch it uninterrupted if you would like to. And, of course, check out the description for other ways you can interact with me and others involved with this channel. Of course, throw a thumbs up, a like on this video if you enjoyed it and maybe learned a thing or two. I know I did. It will really help it out. I do appreciate it. Of course, you can subscribe, join our amazing community we have here. We're on the road to 100,000 subs. Thank you. Thank you, each and every one of you. We are doing really, really well. And with that being said, guys, I can't wait to see what you have to say in the comments down below. My name is Ian. You're watching IWrocker. Until next time, guys, stay safe out there. Be nice, and I'll catch you later.